Most everyone in Utah remembers 1896 as the year the territory became a state. I remember it as the year the Great Brain reformed. That's what we called my brother Tom, because he was smarter than every kid in town. We'd all been swindled by Tom at least once, so we should know. While most kids were reading Black Beauty and Huckleberry Finn, Tom was studying the encyclopedia. He said his great brain had to know everything. My dog Brownie was my best friend. He was my present from Papa on my fifth birthday. He wasn't a purebred, but he was every bit as smart. He didn't like other dogs. If they wanted to fight, he'd fight them and always win. Every dog in Aidenville was afraid of him. It kind of reminded me of my brother Tom. For being only 12, Tom really had a way with words. I could never tell when he was swindling me or just being a good brother. Like that summer, he wanted to sell me his bike. Having a bike was everything. I should know. The bike Tom wanted to sell me was my Christmas present that year. Tom won it on a bet, and now he wanted to charge me a nickel a week for 3 years to buy it back.
Good morning, Uncle Mark.
Good morning, Uncle Mark.
Uncle Mark was the sheriff. Except when Tom was getting into trouble, there wasn't much for him to do. I wasn't sure why Tom wanted to sell me my bike back. He did say I was a growing boy and needed all the exercise I could get. He said muscles were just as important as brains. I wasn't sure, because here I was buying my own bike.
But a nickel a week is half my loan.
J.D., if you own your own bike, then you can rent it at a penny a day. That's 7 cents a week. After you pay my nickel, you'll make 2 cents a week profit.
What's the catch?
No catch.
That Basil sure had courage. No kid in his right mind would ever wear an outfit like that. He was the first genuine immigrant boy I ever knew.
Hello, Mr. Cocovina.
Hello, boys.
Is it a deal?
Sounds fair.
But you have to assume all responsibilities, like keeping it clean and taking care of the tires.
Sure.
That's Mr. Mercer, my brother Swain. And that's my papa. He was the smartest man in town, but he had one weakness. He was forever buying useless inventions.
Nothing I hate worse than being swindled. Remind me to write the president of this company. Who does he think he's dealing with?
I think he knows, Papa.
Mr. Mercer really liked kids. Almost as much as Swin liked his animals. Swin wanted to be a veterinarian, which explained why he was so finicky about me touching them. He didn't think I was gentle enough. I was.
Are they ready yet, Papa?
Hot off the press. And guess who set the type?
When can I start helping you, Papa?
You already are. Delivering the papers is very important.
Typesetting is too difficult for little boys.
You learned it. Come on, J.D.
Papa, what's more important, brains or muscles?
I'd have to say brains, J.D. A man with brains always hires a man with muscles to do his work.
But see you later.
Uh-oh. Here comes Mrs. Granger.
Good morning, boys.
The town snoop. Her hair always looked like it'd been in a dog fight. Here I am getting swindled again. You'd think Tom would show a little mercy on his own brother. What you're seeing happened time and time again. I knew Tom had tricked me. There was nothing I could do about it.
It's not fake.
Delivering newspapers is part of the deal that goes with the bike. Off you go, J.D. Mama's not going to like this one bit.
Papa, how did I manage to get the youngest con man in the West for a brother?
Well, it's a great kid.
Yeah. Hey, you don't belong here.
Watch you push it.
Look at his funny hat.
He looks just like his girl. Did you see that?
What's the matter, Mom?
We've got to get Squint. You should see what Sammy Leeds is doing to the great kid.
Come on.
Don't we need Squint?
Trying to hurt him.
I knew that, and you knew that. Basil didn't.
Just Tom. Vasilios.
That's a funny name. Not half as funny as Just Tom. Hello, Uncle Martin.
We found out Basil didn't know a word of English. He'd only been in America 1 week. I wondered how strange it must be to come to a place where no one understood you. Mr. Kokovinas came to town 4 years before from Greece. He left his wife and son behind until he saved up enough money working in the mines to open the Palace Cafe and bring them to America. I knew how happy he was not being alone anymore.
Just Tom, that's John.
Beep Sue.
Beef stew, Mama. You saved my son from bully.
Yes, Mr. Kokovinas. But tell him that my name is Tom, and that my brother's name is John.
I fili su ke Tom ke John. In English, you say my son's name is Basil.
Basil. Patera samu ares in atuskaleso na fane mazimu.
My son would like to invite you and your brother to have lunch with him. How about a bowl of chili, coconut cream pie?
All right.
You'll be my son's friend. I give you anything you want.
Mr. Kokovinas, there are certain things that Basil will need to play with the other kids. You know, marbles, baseballs, slingshots. I'll be glad to help him get them. But it will cost some money. Thank you, Mr. Kokovinas. That should just about cover it.
We had one of the nicest homes in Aidenville and the only water closet. No one ever heard of putting an outhouse inside, but it turned out to be one of Papa's few inventions that didn't end up in the attic. On the day it was installed, Tom charged kids a penny apiece to watch it flush. He said it was worth it to watch history being made. Mama made him give the money back. She was the most beautiful woman on earth.
At times like this, I wish I were their age.
Not with Tom in the same town.
Oh, Bertha, he's not a malicious boy.
It wasn't my guardian angel to put a garter snake in my bed the first night I was here.
But that was so long ago.
Well, I have a long memory.
Aunt Bertha wasn't really our aunt, but we called her that because she was just like part of the family. I knew Tom would sell Basil everything but the kitchen sink to get his hands on that silver dollar. Tom never ceased to amaze me. He was able to get rid of all his old junk without saying one word.
How do you like Marvel so far? I'm not playing for keeps.
Aren't you ashamed for unloading all your old junk on Basil and cheating him out of 90 cents?
It wasn't junk. It was all stuff that American kids have.
Well, take these secondhand marbles. You charged him as much as new ones.
That's enough marbles for one day. Tomorrow we learn English.
First word you should teach him, a sucker.
I guess your brain is too little to understand. You see how happy I made Basil? And you saw how happy I made his father. Would you rather abandon Basil and let all the other kids make a fool out of him like they did this morning? I think you owe me an apology, J.D.
I'm sorry.
J.D., let me meet Brownie and Lady, and I'll see you get the pick of the litter.
I don't need you for that. I'm the owner of the mail dog.
I get the pick of the litter anyway.
You'll probably pick the worst pup in the litter.
How much will it cost me?
How can you think such a thing? You know I'm good at judging puppies. I just don't want my own brother to get stung.
You mean you'll do it for nothing?
Of course, J.D.
It's a deal. And remember, you said it wouldn't cost me anything.
Swim? How long do you think it'll take me to learn how to swim?
Not long at all. I have a foolproof method.
Let me go! I'll drown!
You won't drown, just dog paddle. And it won't do any good to yell for help, J.D., because I'm not gonna jump in after you.
Please let me go.
Do you want me to tell Poppy you acted like a coward and disgraced the name of Fitzgerald in front of all these kids?
Okay, I'll go, but by myself.
Trestle,
or I'll throw you off until you do.
Mom and Papa will never forgive you two if I drown.
Hello, Dr. Leroy. Won't you come in?
I knew it. Swin's got the measles. You know what that means.
I suspected as much. Well?
It seems silly for J.D. and me to get the measles just because Swin's got them. Maybe J.D. and I are immune.
If you are, we'll soon find out.
But, Mama, I never get a chance to catch a disease first. It ain't fair.
Isn't fair, and I don't want to hear another word.
Mama had a system when we got sick. She believed in getting us all infected with the disease at the same time and getting it over with. Mama said a dark room would make our eyes feel better. But it made me sicker not seeing what was going on outside.
How have all my patients been this week?
Not patient. Come on in, doctor. Got his appetite back.
Fever's gone. Well, I don't see why we have to have him in here with his two sick brothers.
Swin, you can move back to your room now.
Thanks, Mama.
Come on, Swin.
Bye-bye, brothers.
All a part of growing up, boys.
I'm hungry.
Oh, no. It's too bad you couldn't have had breakfast this morning. Mama baked your favorite sourdough biscuits, and then she fried me two big eggs with lots of crisp bacon. Well. Have a good day, brothers.
You better recover soon, or old Swin will celebrate your birthday for you.
Aunt Bertha was with us as long as I could remember. After her husband died in a mining accident, she came to live with us. She wasn't a servant, and she wouldn't accept wages. All she wanted was a home and a place to feel useful. Thank you. Luckily, I got better in time for my 8th birthday. That was the day Uncle Mark gave me my best birthday present ever. Even Tom thought it was pretty special. Summer finally ended, and that meant another year of school. What I didn't know is that it would be the last year we'd have Mrs. Thatcher for a teacher. She really understood kids.
Andy, I want to see you after school. You're old enough to be on time.
Here we go again.
Frank, did you have something to show me?
Frank always had something to show everybody. He was too smart for his own good.
Let's see it, John. What a beauty. You want to sell it?
It's not for sale.
It looks like Tillite, wouldn't you say?
Where's Howard? He's got the mumps. Hey, are you still going to that Henderson bar with Basil and me?
It's too dangerous. Most kids are chicken to come here.
Chicken?
Fraidy cats. Bet you haven't been in a real barn before.
We have barns, yes.
What for?
For cows and horses and chickens.
Greeks have animals like us.
But no fraidy cats. Just cats.
Watch this.
Andy! You are hurt?
Take more than a little cut to hurt me. Give me a word you won't tell anyone about this. Even J.D.
I couldn't stop thinking about Howard having the mumps. I knew this would be my big chance to get sick first. Poor Howard. He was always reading those baby books.
Howard? Howard? Where are you?
You can't come in here. Breathe on me. Infect me. If you gone crazy, I'm not sure it hurt bad. It even hurts to talk. For once, I want to be the first one to get sick, so when I get better, I can really rub it in good. If you're a real pal, you'll give me the mumps. All right, but I still think you're nuts. Now we're in for it. Quick, under the bed.
Are you all right, dear?
I'm fine, Mom.
Well, I'm going to go finish raking the leaves in the front yard. I won't be long.
You say so, John.
Andy! Andy, where are you?
Andy knew he'd get a whipping if he told his parents he'd been playing in Henderson's barn. All the kids in town were forbidden to play there after Sammy Leeds broke his leg. I checked my jaws every day after Howard breathed on me. 3 weeks had passed and nothing happened. I was beginning to think I was immune. I was so healthy it was sickening.
Ready? Ready? Judy?
You all right? Well, come on downstairs, honey. Supper's ready.
I'm letting the rabbit go tomorrow, Mama.
Well, please make sure Brownie's locked up before you do. I'm not willing to make rabbit stew again.
Biscuits, J.D.? Well, what's the matter, honey? Does it hurt to chew?
A little.
Let me have a look at you. Does that hurt?
It hurts. It hurts.
There seems to be some swelling. Are you sure, Mama? Well, I don't know why it pleases you so much. I think you're coming down with the mumps. Finish your supper, and then you'll get into bed. I'm going to telephone Dr. Leroy.
Boy to bed right away. He's got a fever.
The mumps, all right.
Maybe I've got a little brain, but I figured out how to get sick first for a change. I sneaked into Howard K's house and got him to give me the mumps.
You mean you got the mumps on purpose just so you could give them to me and Tom?
You guessed it. It'll take you 3 weeks under Mama's system for you to get them. By that time, I'll be all better. I'll be the one who rubs it in. I'll be the one who's outside playing, while you two are in bed, groaning in pain.
Don't say it, Mama.
It'd be easier if we just moved downstairs for good.
Mama, they're torturing me. Tell him I'm sick.
Your brothers have every right to tease you this way.
Tease me? It's worse than Indian torture.
Then bear it like an Indian. You're the one that wanted the mop so badly. I think you deserve your brother's punishment.
Sorry for J.D. It's been over a week now. He's been in there suffering while we're out here having fun. You know, for once, I think we're immune. Did you say something? Thinking of you during dinner tonight. While you're having pea soup, I'll be stuffing myself with Mama's fried chicken and a piece of Aunt Bertha's delicious apple pie. Mmm.
did it.
As soon as I finish my candy, I'm gonna go outside to play. You'll hear me whistling happily while you two lie here in misery.
I got news for you, J.D. Beginning right now, Swin and me are gonna give you the silent treatment for a whole month.
The silent treatment. My revenge had turned sour. Papa and Mama had a way of punishing us that was 10 times worse than a whipping. They just stopped talking to us. But that was mild next to the silent treatment from Tom and Swin. Brownie couldn't help.
Dirty trick you pulled on Swin and me. Do you admit it was a dirty trick?
Yes.
Do you admit you should be punished for it?
Yes. But not too much punishment.
There are two ways to punish you. Giving you the silent treatment is one.
I'll go crazy if you do. You said there were two ways?
The other way would be to make you give up something that you really want to keep. If you agree to give up something that you really like, I'd get Swin to call off the silent treatment.
I'll give you anything I've got.
Even the Indian belt Uncle Mark gave you for your birthday? Forget it, J.D. These are the last words I'll speak to you for a month. And to show you my heart's in the right place, J.D., I'm not going to charge you anything for getting Swin to lift off the silent treatment.
You sure are good to me.
That's what brothers are for.
Doc, you've got to come to my place. Andy's real sick.
I'll need my bag.
Bishop, what's wrong with Mr. Anderson?
It's Andy. Something about him being sick.
Tina, get the children. We better get out to the Anderson.
You're going to be all right, son. Leg is gangrene. It's too far gone to save.
What are you saying, Doctor?
If you want to save your boy's life, I've got to take that leg. The infection is spreading.
There must be another way.
Thank you.
Tina, I'll need your help. And Fitz, I'll need you to bring some things from my office. Do I have your permission?
Come on, boys. Let's go outside.
He's a strong boy. He'll do just fine. Now let's get to work.
I wish Miss Thatcher was
going. You'll find I'm not as understanding as Miss Thatcher. I'm here to educate you children. I will not tolerate anything that interferes with your education. The paddle will be used on boys who shoot spitballs and dip girls' pigtails in inkwells and throw chalk. This will be used on the palms of girls who break the rules. And they will remain after school to clean blackboards and erasers. Are there any questions? I want the boy who did that to come right up here. What is your name?
Basil.
Come here, Basil.
I don't do it.
If you didn't, you must have seen who did.
I know, see. Please don't punish me. I am a good boy.
Stop that! Now either tell me who did it, or come up here and take a paddling yourself.
You can't paddle, Basil. He didn't do it.
Then you must know who did. I want his name.
I'm no tattletale.
Basil, return to your desk. Come here. You will tell me who put the frog in her desk, or take a paddling yourself.
You can't paddle me for something I didn't do.
But I can paddle you for not telling me who did.
That's not fair. I'm not gonna tell, and I'm not gonna take a paddling either.
We'll see about that. Maybe that will teach you to respect your teacher.
You'll be sorry for this.
You keep a civil tongue in your head, or I'll give you another paddling you won't forget. Now, who can tell me about the Gettysburg Address? Does anybody know who wrote this famous document?
Abraham Lincoln. He was the 16th president of the United States. He read the Gettysburg Address on November 19th, 1863 in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania.
He's a mean one, all right. I wonder what his mother was like. I'd hate to be Jimmy Peterson. How would you like Mr. Standish living in the same house with you? Mr. Standish will be sorry he paddled me because I wouldn't be a tattletale. What are you going to do? I'm going to work on getting rid of it. Oh, boy. I'd hate to be in his shoes.
Where are you going?
We're gonna go over to Fitzgerald's to play.
Do you want to try on my wooden leg again?
Nah, not today.
Can I come play?
Sure. Come on, Pigleg.
Where are you going, son?
We're going over to the Fitzgeralds to play.
Other kids. My great brain has done it again. We won't have to worry about Mr. Standish anymore. Before I tell you my plan, I want you all to take an oath on the skull of this dead Indian chief. Now, I want you all to place your right hand on the skull. I call upon the ghost of this dead Indian chief to come back to Earth and cut out the tongue of anyone who tells. Behold, the first step in the downfall of Mr. Standish.
Good morning, Martha. I have something very serious I want to talk to you about. You'll never guess what I found this morning when I went to the trash can.
What did you find?
And there were more where this came from. Simply disgraceful.
Then why are you telling me this? You know I don't touch strong drink.
I'll thank you, Mrs. Peterson, to tell your boarders I do not want them throwing their empty whiskey bottles in my trash cans.
Well, I'll thank you, Mrs. Taylor, not to go accusing my boarders. None of them touches a drop.
You and your boarders are the only people on the block who aren't Mormons.
Then you must have a backslider in your midst. I wouldn't take a boarder who drank or smoked.
It was bad enough having Mr. Standish as a teacher. But poor Jimmy had to live with him, too. That's why he picked the most dangerous job of all, planting a whiskey bottle in Mr. Standish's coat at school. My job was slipping a note under the door of Calvin Whitlock, president of the school board.
It was under the door, Mr. Whitlock.
The kids were all scared of Mr. Whitlock. We never saw him smile.
Mrs. Yates, get me Bishop Aiden and Mrs. Granger. Mrs. Granger, Calvin Whitlock. I'm convening an emergency meeting of the school board.
And that's why history is so important. We must learn from our mistakes.
You'll dismiss school for today, Mr. Standish, and report to my office this afternoon at 2 o'clock sharp.
I told you I'd make Mr. Standish sorry he paddled me. He was a fool to go up against the great brain.
You hardly said a word at supper. What's wrong?
Mr. Standish, can't get him off my mind. The man swore to me he never took a drink in his life.
Isn't that what a secret drinker would say, especially a teacher?
He thinks someone framed him.
Who would do a contemptible thing like that?
Why do you say contemptible?
Now, what would you call a person who ruined my reputation with false evidence?
But that's different. Nobody likes Mr. Standish.
That's no excuse, Tom. If Mr. Standish is innocent, and somebody in this town has done to him one of the cruelest things that a person can do. I can't help feeling sorry for him, guilty or innocent.
But, Papa, Mr. Standish had no right paddling me for not tattletelling.
Tom, if you know something that could prove Mr. Standish innocent, you'd better speak up.
You had no right to paddle me.
Not you. To ruin a man's good name is about the meanest, lowest thing a person can do. If you can save Mr. Standish's reputation, you better start talking.
I swore I'd never tell.
There comes a time in a man's life when he must break his word to help somebody.
But you said that a man's word was his bond.
We will have no more of this nonsense, Tom Dennis. A man's entire future's at stake. You will tell your father and me exactly what happened.
All right. I'll tell. One night after curfew, we sneaked back of the White Horse Saloon and found some whiskey bottles. We planted empties in Mrs. Taylor's trash can. We poured whiskey into three other bottles, two for Mr. Standish's room and one for inside his coat at school. We wanted to make sure. Of course, to get the ball rolling, we had to put that note under Mr. Whitlock's door. Then we just let nature take its course.
Mr.
I have something to say to one boy in this room. In all my years of teaching, I've never witnessed a more despicable act by a child or adult. What happened last night almost ruined my career. It was vicious and cruel. Last night, I could have paddled this boy until he couldn't walk. This morning, well, I thought of his great courage and honesty. He saved me from a dreadful fate. And so, I want to thank him. Regardless of what he did to me, he more than made up for it. Coming to my defense.
He did it again.
Yesterday he spilled a whole dozen eggs. Today he fell with the kindler.
We'd better get used to it. He'll be taken care of for the rest of his life. Just plumb useless.
After the novelty of Andy's peg leg wore off, none of the kids wanted to play with him anymore. So his father bought him an erector set. But Andy didn't want to stay home alone. That's why I'm glad I didn't go play baseball that afternoon.
You went to play ball.
I changed my mind.
Because you feel sorry for me.
Yeah. I guess. Is it really so bad having a pig leg?
I can't play ball with the other kids. I can't even do my own chores.
What's wrong with that?
My pa called me plumb useless. Because he'll have to take care of me for the rest of my life. What's the use of me going on living when I'm just plumb useless? I'm gonna do myself in.
You mean you're going to kill yourself?
Give me one good reason why not.
You're the only kid in town with an erector set.
What good is an erector set when I'm just plumb useless? Will you help me, Tom?
Sure.
I sure appreciate this, John. You're a real friend. I'm gonna give you my peg leg.
What will I do with it?
I don't know. Just thought you might like it to sort of remember me by.
That would be nice.
Well, I'm ready, John.
Goodbye, Andy.
Gee whiz, John, couldn't you tie a knot that would hold?
You could have pretended the sack didn't open and let yourself drown.
When you know how to swim, you just can't let yourself drown.
I'll go back to the barn and get another sack.
It's too darn cold. Let's figure out a better way.
Maybe you'll catch pneumonia and die.
Andy and me sat around all afternoon trying to think of a better way to end his misery. He didn't want to use a gun because he was afraid of blood. He said poison would make him sick. I finally had a brainstorm.
Are you ready, Andy?
Yes, JD.
We tried drowning, but that wouldn't work.
You could have killed him.
I know. Andy wants to do himself in because he's useless with his new leg. Take that off. Get down here.
Why did you have to butt in?
Nobody's useless.
Even with your great brain, you can't grow me another leg.
No, but my great brain can prove to the world that you aren't useless.
If you can, I'll give you anything I've got.
Even your erector set?
I don't know if my pa would let me.
What would your pa do with an erector set if you committed suicide? First thing you've got to do is stop feeling sorry for yourself.
Well, you'd feel sorry for yourself, too, if you had a wooden leg.
No, I wouldn't, because I'd show everybody that a wooden leg didn't make any difference. We'll start by making you the best Indian wrestler in town.
You're kidding. Fat chance.
Now listen to me, Angie. When a person loses one leg, he gets twice the strength in the other leg. That means you've got double the strength in your left leg as any kid your age and size in town. My father's the smartest man in Aidenville, and he says this is true. Are you calling my father a liar?
Gosh, no.
Then you must believe me. We'll start tomorrow.
Thank you, Andy. Phoebe?
Do you think I can start doing my chores at home now?
No.
You need at least another week of practice. But we don't want to take any chances that your father won't be completely satisfied.
Looking at the new champion Indian wrestler. You saw for yourself, Tom.
You're not champ until you beat everyone.
There's no one left but Jimmy and you.
I'll try.
Ready. That's everyone, except you, Tom.
I'm ready.
Ready. That makes me champ.
There's one more challenger. Andy?
It wouldn't be fair to wrestle a cripple.
You can't be champ unless you take on all challengers.
I'll go easy on you, peg leg. Ready.
One, two, three.
Come on.
I wasn't set.
All right. Two out of three.
Ready.
Champion. You won fair and square, Sammy.
Now do you think I'm ready?
And the rector said, like I promised. I told Pa all that you did for me. He said it'd be okay if I gave it to you.
It's true my great brain saved you from a suicide grave. It's also true I proved you weren't useless. And it's true we made a deal. But it just doesn't seem right somehow for me to take your rector set.
You mean you don't want it?
Of course I want it. But it just doesn't seem right getting paid for helping somebody. You keep the set, Andy. I'll come over and play with it sometime.
You can come over and play anytime. Pa said to thank you for him. Ma said God bless you, and that she's gonna pray for you. Ain't no way for me to say what I feel inside. You're making me so I'm not useless anymore. Guess I'll have to thank you in my prayers and ask God to bless you too.
Thanks, Andy.
I'm gonna phone Dr. Leroy right away.
I'm not sick, J.D.
Matter of fact, I feel kind of good.
Here's your belt back. It's a little worn by now, but still. The only genuine Indian beaded belt in Maidenville. Please, J.D. If you love me as a brother, you'll take it back.
Is this the day that the great brain really reformed?
Things are going to be mighty dull around here.
And so, 1 week before Thanksgiving of that year, a miracle happened in Nadenville. Because of Andy Anderson, the great brain had reformed. It really gave our whole family something to be thankful for. Things were mighty dull after Tom decided to go straight. So dull, Papa didn't even bother coming upstairs to see if Tom was in bed the night the schoolhouse burned to the ground.
When I feel all alone and all my world is done.